creature and why not God through the pen of inspiration.
Allow
us to be extremely careful that you don't just follow what you hear being said. Oh, so and so say this, so that's what I don't like to call. Because human beings can mislead.
I
can mislead. I don't want you to trust me because I am a sinner like you. I don't want you to trust any of the speakers that are speaking here. I want you to trust the Word of God and the Spirit of Inspiration. There are many people in the past who have been great speakers. They have had a big following, but one moment of failure has misled thousands of those that look up to them. And so our only safety, our only example is Jesus Christ. And you must study for yourself so that you make sure that this is so. Before we start, I'd like us to seek the Lord.
Services, in our lifestyles,
even in our education. And really, this is the main theme of the discussion this week. It is not something new that we are learning. It is an appeal God is making. Why have we forsaken his way of education and gone after systems that are broken, which cannot hold any water? That is the question really that is being asked. Because there is a tendency to think that what you have is really the correct thing and what we are telling you is something new. No. We have forsaken the fountain of living waters. And so I'd like us to very quickly, I have quite a number of slides today, and so I want us to be alert. I trust that you have drunk water after your breakfast, because your brain cannot function when you are dehydrated. And I can see that very easily from here. So please make sure you have given your brain enough water so that it can work. We're going to do quite a bit of reading. We have to read anyway because we still love our social media. And I know many of us don't read after this conference. You can't hold your attention long enough. You know, the culture of social media has trained us to have a very short attention span. You can't hold a 10-15-page chapter and finish without getting distracted. That is the tragedy of social media. We'll talk about that a bit more later this week. God willing. The education which was applied for the children of Israel was soul culture, pure and simple. Its object was to develop the soul, which is God in man and the divinity. So planned that every true Jew should be a Godman. Education was to develop the spark of divinity bestowed in God. It was the privilege of every Jew to have a deep double, that one Jew Christ, the Spirit without measure. And so we want to see what plan that would take a newborn babe and taking two lives, making one unit in a nation of spiritual beings. This is living fountains and broken systems by P. A. Sutherland. He was a student of Ellen G. White, and him and Morgan, they started the Madison School. And so he wrote this book in 1900. He was still in his youthful days, and he was still fresh in the principles of true education that he learned from Ellen G. White. And so if you can get hold of this book, it's very good. Okay? I just want us to go through very quickly. One, see the story of Hannah, the wife of Manoah. And this is really from the beginning, when the children are very small, what was God's plan? Okay? And we will even look at the history as been recorded by the secular writer, painter, history of education. Education was restricted to the family in which the father was the principal teacher. There were no proper schools, no professional teachers. Yet, the instruction of the Jew embraced a vast number of particulars. So, in the ancient Jewish tradition, the father was the teacher. Okay? And even Hinsdale also says, Jewish education began with the mother. What the true Jewish mother considered as a teacher was, we know from the Testament and from many other sources. These are secular writers who are telling you that if you want to know how education was done, we will know it from where? From the scripture. Now, the outsiders are telling us that the way to find true education is from the Bible. The very household duties that she performed molded our children in accordance with the national discipline. The Sabbath meal, the kindling of the Sabbath lamb, the setting apart of a portion of the dough from the bread for the household. These are the instances which every child, as he clung to his mother's cuts, must have been familiar. The bit of parchment fastened to the doorpost on which the name of the Most High was written would be among the first things to arrest his attention. Okay? It was in the school of the mother's knee that the stories of patriots and prophets, of statesmen and warriors, of poets and sages, of kings and judges, wise men and patriots, and of the great lawkeeper himself, they're all forming the very best body of material for the purpose of child nurture, found in any language, were told and retold until they became part of the mind itself. understand the science of education, we will not have a share in the kingdom. This is how the Israelite mother trained her children. Stories by the fireside, in the evening, they were told and retold until they became part of the child. From the home school, we followed the Jewish child to the synagogue or church school. Moses was instructed by the Lord to make every priest a teacher. So the nation had a whole tribe of teachers. As every town had its synagogue, so a town in which there is no school must perish. Watching again from Hinsdale, the children were gathered for instruction in the synagogues and schoolhouses, where the teacher general, the chosen officer of the synagogue, imparted to them the precious knowledge of the law. With constant adaptation to their capacity, with unwearied patience, intense earnestness, strictness tempered by kindness, above all, with the highest object of training ever in view. The children, to keep the children from all contact with vice, to train them to gentleness, even when bitterest wrong had been received, to show sin in its repulsiveness, rather than to terrify by its consequences, to train to strict truthfulness, to avoid all that might lead to disagreeable or indelicate thoughts, and to do all this without showing partiality, without either undue severity or laxity of discipline, with judicious increase of study and work, with careful attention to thoroughness in acquiring knowledge. All this and more constituted the ideal self before it, and made its office of such a high esteem. These teachers took the young at the most critical period of their development, and how thoroughly they understood the needs of this development mind. Up to 10 years of age. Did you see that?
Yes.
Up to 10 years of age. The Bible was what? From 10 to 15. Now, these are secular writers. Hinsdale, Painter, they are secular historians. And they are telling you what the prophet was telling us the other day, that the Bible should be our chief textbook. Up to 10 years of age. In fact, they say that by age 7, the child has already made a foundation for his future life. Whatever you do after age 7, it's too late. And so, if you can teach the child from the Bible up to 10 years, you have secured that child. You follow that biblical injunction that train up a child in the way that he should go. That should be until age 10. The Bible should be the main text, and no other books. We find today from kindergarten, they're reading about monkeys and programs. From 10 to 15, the listener or traditional law was used, and after that, the pupil was admitted to the discussion of the rabbinical schools. So extensive a course of study, however, was taken only by those who showed decided aptitude for learning. Bible study began with the book of Leviticus, then came other parts of the Pentateuch, next the prophets, and finally the geography. Okay? When children were fortified by such an education from infancy to manhood, it is little wonder that the influence which the nation has exerted upon the world is incalculable. It has supplied the basis of all true theology. It has given a system of faultless morality, and in Christianity it has provided the most perfect form of religion. The civilization of Europe and America can be directly traced to the Jews. How many of you guys think that civilization came from Europe and from America? Mm-hmm. It came from the Bible. And from the Bible nation. Let's look at the life of John the Baptist and see how did he do it. Luke chapter 1, verse 13. Fear not,
spoke to the mother long before the child was born. And they always had a special message on how the mother was to rear the child. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and shall be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall eat unto the Lord their God. We shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his way, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercies of our God, whereby the day spring on high hath filled us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way of peace. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, and was in the deserts. And was where?
In the deserts.
In the city, in the apartments, and the secular schools of today, in the streets. He was in the deserts. Till the day of issuing of Israel. John was to go forth as Jehovah's messenger to bring men to the light of life. He must give a new direction to their thoughts. He must impress them with the holiness of God's requirements and their needs of his perfect righteousness. Such a messenger must be holy. He must be a temple for the indwelling spirit of God. In order to fulfill his mission, he must have a sound physical constitution. Many of our schools, children do not have a sound physical constitution. They're always getting sick. They don't have time to do proper physical work. Okay? They're always sitting down the whole day in front of books. They have very poor constitution and mental and spiritual strength. Therefore, it will be necessary for him to control the appetites and passions. He must be able so to control his powers that he should stand among men as unmoved by surrounding circumstances, as the rocks and the mountains of the wilderness. In the time of John the Baptist, greed for riches, and the love of luxury and display had become widespread. Sensuous pleasures, feasting and drinking were causing physical disease and degeneration, benumbing the spiritual perception and lessening the sensibility to sin. That's what they do. Greed for riches, love of luxury and display, and sensuous pleasures, feasting and drinking. What do? They cause physical disease and degeneracy, and they benumb the spiritual perception. It's benumbing spiritual perception when you don't make the difference between the holy and the common. It is easy for you to break the Sabbath. It is easy for you to rationalize and say God will understand. It is easy for you to bribe to get the contract. John was to stand as a reformer and by his abstemious life and plain dress, he was to rebuke the excess of his time. That's the directions given to the parents of John, a lesson of temperance by an angel from the throne of heaven. And now I will tell you, that angel was the angel that stands next to God. How important was that message? That God had to send the angel that stands next to him. In the childhood and youth, the character is most impressive. The power of self-control should then be acquired by the fireside and at the family board. Influences are exerted whose results are as enduring as eternity. Now, if the child should be taught by the fireside, by the family board, how can you do that in the current system where the child leaves the house even before breakfast is ready? Where the child spends most of the time with strangers who don't even believe in God? And where the child is taught principles that are opposite to what you know and believe in the Bible? How can we rationalize with that? More than any natural endowment, the habits established in early years decide whether a man will be victorious or vanquished in the battle of life. Youth is the sowing time. Who is sowing for your children? Who is sowing in the soil of your children's mind? Who do you allow to get into the garden of your children's mind? Because youth is the sowing time. Will you let a stranger sow strange seed in the mind of your children? If youth is the sowing time. Because the mind is likened in the Bible as the soil, isn't it? And he who hears these words of mine is likened to a man, the sower that went to sow, isn't it? Some seed fell where? By the wayside. And Jesus Christ described those seeds, the meaning of the wayside. The seed that fell by the thorns, the cares of this life, they chop out the seed. The soil is the mind. And if the mind is not protected, it can be crowded with the things of this life. You may have a stranger to come and sow the wrong seed, and you shall reap a harvest of grief and destruction and loss. Youth is the sowing time. It determines the character of the harvest for this life and for the life to come. In preparing the way for Christ's first advent, he was representative of those who were to prepare people for our Lord's second coming. The world is given to self-indulgence, errors and fables abound. Satan's snares for destroying souls are multiplied. All who would perfect holiness in the fear of God must learn the lessons of temperance and self-control. The appetites and passions must be held in subjection to the higher powers of the mind. This self-discipline is essential to that mental strength and spiritual insight which will enable us to understand and to practice the sacred truths of God's word. Okay? For this reason, temperance finds its place in the work of preparation for the second coming. Okay? In the natural order of things, the son of Zacharias would have been educated for the priesthood because his father was a priest, isn't he? Okay? But the training of the rabbinical schools would have unfitted for this one. If the rabbinical schools were not suitable for training as a priest, how about our secular schools? Surely the rabbinical schools even used scripture, except they had corrupted the scripture. But at least they would claim the name of the Lord. How about our schools that even openly reject the word of God? God did not send him to the teachers of theology to learn how to interpret the scripture. What options did the prophet have, since there was no school fitted for him for his day? It was a lonely region where he found his home, in the midst of barren hills, wild ravines, and rocky caves. But it was his choice to forego the enjoyments and luxuries of life for the stern discipline of the wilderness. We are asking you to get out of the cities and get the stern discipline of not a fertile country. But where? Where? I know it's a feeble answer. The wilderness. Alright. Here, his surroundings were favorable for habits of simplicity and self-denial. Uninterrupted by the clamor of the world, he could hear study the lessons of nature, of revelation, and of progress. The words of the angels Zacharias had been often repeated to John by his God-fearing parents. From childhood, his mission had been kept before him. Today, we don't tell our children their mission. We ask them, what's your mission? What do you want to do? Undeveloped minds, and what do you call them? There's a phrase that I used the other day. Uninformed judgments. You are asking them what they want to do for life, instead of giving them their mission. God has told us the mission for our children. To him, the solitude of the desert was a welcome escape from society in which suspicion and belief and impurity had become well-nigh all-pervading. He distrusted his own power to withstand temptation
and shrunk from constant contact with sin, lest he should lose the sense of his exceeding sinfulness. He called him to the desert that he might learn of nature and nature's God. But the life of John was not spent in idleness, in a ascetic group, or in selfish isolation. From time to time, he went forth to mingle with men, and he was an ever-interested observer of what was passing in the world. From his quiet retreat, he watched the unfolding events. John found in the wilderness his school and his sanctuary. Like Moses amid the mountains of Midian, he was shut in by God's presence and surrounded by the evidences of his power. Alright, so let's look at the education of Jesus Christ. And you know what John did? He was the greatest prophet ever lived. Jesus Christ described him as that among all born of women, there is none greater than John. Okay? And so from that you can see what a desert life, a countryside life can do in preparing the greatest of the men. John, remember, he rebuked the errors of Herod. He rebuked Herod for taking his brother's wife. He did not fear to call sin by its name. But today, we like to be careful not to offend people. We like to be careful even when you see your friend is in the wrong course. We will not want to offend them. And we would rather they suffer eternal destruction. Their blood will be called upon our heads when we do not stand for the truth. Okay? Thou shalt not bear false witnesses. Mm-hmm. False witnesses includes keeping silent when you should be pointing out the error. Okay? In love. Alright? So let's look at the education of Jesus Christ. If I'm going too far, please let me know. Alright? Jesus grew in nothing. Again, we want to follow up a little bit on the life, the early childhood of Jesus Christ. Then we will discuss the principles that Christ came to give in true education. Grew up in Nazareth, such was the locality that it had a proverbial reputation. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Yet here the Savior of the world lived with humble parents. Early years of Jesus found him at his mother's knee. Only two textbooks were used for his training. What were they? Scripture and what?
Nature.
In his later years, his parables were full of references to nature, to farming, that his hearers could immediately recognize the truth behind the lessons. Prophecy says about his growth, for he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He had no form, no comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire. Okay? The scriptures further state, and the child grew and waxed strong in spirit. Now, this sounds familiar. Where did we read this? Who else grew? It was John. All of them were in the countryside, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. From the earliest times, the faithful in Israel had given much care to the education of the youth. The Lord had directed that even from babyhood, the children should be taught of his goodness and his greatness, especially as revealed in his law and shown in the history of Israel. The children should be taught of God's goodness and his greatness. The children should not be taught of their goodness and their greatness. We should not teach the children how good they are. We should not praise them during their birthdays and tell them they are very good and buy them gifts when they have done nothing. It is idolatry that we begin to teach the children when we follow the ways of the world. Instead, we should point them to who?
Christ.
True education would lead the youth to seek the Lord if haply they might feel after him and find him. But the Jewish teachers gave their attention to matters of service. The mind was crowded with material that was worthless to the learner, that would not be recognized in the higher schools of the courts above. Okay? The experience which is obtained through a personal acceptance of God's word had no place in the educational system. You can see that? That experience that would be obtained through a personal acceptance of God's word. When we can accept that the word of God and what it says, it did have a place in that educational system. Does it have a place today? In the educational system of today?
It doesn't. Absorbed in the round of externals, the students found no quiet hours to spend with God. They did not hear his voice speaking to the heart. In their search after knowledge, they turned away from the source of wisdom. What foolishness. The great essentials of the service of God were neglected. The principles of the law were obscured. That which was regarded as superior education was the greatest hindrance to development. Under the training of the rabbis, the powers of the youth were repressed. Their minds became cramped and narrow. When you want to study the Word of God, you are told, no, today there is no Bible study. Today everybody will meet in the main sanctuary. Today the youth cannot have Bible study. I don't know about you, but in the church I was in, that is the common phrase every Sabbath. Today there is no meeting. You are not having your Bible study. Today you shall come and join with the rest of the congregation as you hear fables and stories. The powers of the youth today are repressed in our churches. They are not allowed to think and study the Word for themselves. The child Jesus did not receive instruction in the synagogue schools. His mother was his first human teacher. From her lips and from the scrolls of the prophets, he learned of heavenly things, the very words which he himself had spoken to Moses for Israel. He was now taught at his mother's knee. It is Jesus Christ who spoke to Moses. It is Jesus Christ who gave the law at Mount Sinai. He is the one who spoke and the mountain shook and the children of Israel were trembling. And now those words he spoke, he was now learning them at his mother's knee. What you need. As he advanced from childhood to youth, he did not seek the schools of the rabbis. He needed not the education to be obtained from such sources, for God was his instructor. Who teacheth like he? Question asked during the Savior's ministry, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned, does not indicate that Jesus was unable to read, but merely that he had not received a rabbinical education. Since he gained knowledge as we may do, his intimate acquaintance with the scriptures showed how diligently his early years were given to the study of God's word. And spread out before him was the great library of God's created works. He had made all things studied, the lessons which his own hand had written in his study, in earth and sea and sky. Jesus would not follow any custom that would require him to depart from the will of God, nor would he place himself under the instruction of those who exalted the words of men above the word of God. He shut out of his mind all the sentiments and formalities that are not God for their foundation. He would not give place, he would give no place for these things to influence him. Now, if we are his disciples, this should be our principle. We should not place ourselves under the instruction of those who exalt the words of men above the word of God. Did you understand that statement?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
How many have understood it? Those hands are struggling. How many have understood it? Unless your hand is crippled, can you raise your hand? You should not place yourself under the instruction of those who exalt the words of men above the word of the prophets. Okay? He shut out of his mind all the sentiments and formalities that had not God for their foundation. He would give no place for these things to influence him. Thus, he taught, this is fundamentals for Christian education. Okay? Thus, he taught that it is better to prevent evil than to attempt to correct it after it has gained foothold in the mind. You know, just finish. Just finish your course. Just finish your degree. And then you can go to do medical mission. Just finish. It is better, let's read together.